Hi, I'm Iain, and today we're going to repair this portable air conditioner. Now this thing is doing the classic thing of it just doesn't get cold. Everything else runs, the compressor runs, it turns on, life is good, it just doesn't do what it's supposed to do, which is blow cold air out here, and in this case, because it's a portable one, blow the hot air out a dryer hose out the window. So what we're going to do is go through all the steps of trying to fix this thing. Now, the first thing I did is I took this thing apart ahead of time because I wanted to make sure that this really was the issue we were looking at and that it wasn't some other internal issue. But I let it run for 15 minutes, and while it ran, I kept checking the suction line to the compressor and the discharge line from the compressor to see if the suction line would get cold and if the discharge line would get hot. While it was running, I also kept feeling right here. This is where the capillary tube goes into the evaporator coil, and it did start to get cold right here. It never got cold on the evaporator coil. That stayed at room temperature the whole time. So I know there is some refrigerant in the system because it was able to make this point cold, but there's not enough charge left to actually make the entire thing cold. And I was never able to get it to raise the temperature of the condenser coil even noticeably. So we are very low on refrigerant. Here's something to keep in mind. This is a hermetically sealed system. It's different than a car's air conditioning system that has a belt drive compressor with a seal that can leak refrigerant over time. This is an electric driven compressor that is totally sealed, so there should not be any loss of refrigerant for the life of the system. That refrigerant is in there, it's going to stay in there forever, unless there's a leak. Now, we could do a temporary fix and simply add refrigerant to this thing, but that's not really fixing the thing, because the refrigerant didn't just disappear because it felt like it. There's a leak in this thing somewhere, so I want to fix it correctly, which means find the leak, fix the leak, and then recharge the system. So the very first thing we need to do when working on the system is to get the refrigerant that is left in here and put it in a recovery bottle, so that way when we're all done we can put the refrigerant back in and then make up the difference with new refrigerant. To begin the recovery process, I want to find the process stub on the suction side of the system, which happens to be right here. There's also a process stub on the high side of the system, and I'm going to leave that alone. I'm going to do everything I need to do from the low side right here. And the way I know it's the low side stub is because it's teed into the suction line of the compressor. What I need to do is use this piercing tool. It has a little point right there that stabs into the copper tubing and this big rubber gasket that keeps it from leaking in order to get the refrigerant out of the system. You can also use the bullet piercing valves that have three little set screws that clamp on, and then you attach the recovery machine to that, but I find this is a lot simpler because it just works like a pair of vice grips. First thing I want to do is clean up the process stub just a little bit to remove any kind of oxide on the outside. I'm going to be brazing a service port just like this into this service stub, and it's a lot easier and better to clean it now before it has a hole in it, because I don't want any of the residue from the sanding to get into the system. Now that that's cleaned up, I can go ahead and attach this. I'm going to try and get it as close to the end as possible, so that way when I cut this to put the service valve on, I'll be cutting off the pierced section.
That's one less hole I'll have to braze up. And then we just squeeze it. Just like that.
So now, if I spray some soapy water on here, I shouldn't see any bubbles. And I don't see any bubbles forming, and we've got pressure registered on the gauge. So now that we've got that hooked up and we're registering pressure on the gauge, which means we do have some refrigerant in this system, let's just take a quick tour of the recovery system. So, started out with the piercing valve, that's attached and leak free. Next it comes to the gauge set. You'll notice I don't have the red hose attached because I'm not doing anything with the high side. This is all through the low side, so why have an extra hose kicking around? From there, it goes to the yellow hose, which comes over here to our good friend, the recovery machine. And you'll see the yellow hose attaches right here. This is a filter dryer. Because there might be contaminants in that refrigerant that I pull from that system, I don't want that to contaminate everything else in the recovery cylinder, so we have a filter dryer in line with it. Now we have the recovery machine. So there's an in and an out, and what this is basically just a pump that takes the refrigerant and pushes it into the recovery cylinder. And we've got gauges to tell us what's on the system side and what's on the tank side. And of course, all the valves are shut right now, so we're not registering any pressure. Finally, we have the recovery cylinder on the digital scale. And the reason we have the digital scale is this is a 50-pound cylinder. I can only fill it up 80% of the way. This thing is empty right now. It has a vacuum in it because this is a brand new cylinder. So I know that because the tag on the back of this unit said it had 15.5 ounces of refrigerant in it, I'm not going to hit 40% filling this up. But I am curious how much refrigerant I'm going to get out of this thing, because that'll tell me how badly did it leak. So right now it is 26.488 pounds. What I want to do is zero it out. Again, I know there's nothing in this tank because I just barely pulled a vacuum on it. So we'll be able to tell how much refrigerant do we add to this thing. A recovery tank has two valves, red valve and a blue valve. The blue is for vapor and the red valve is for liquid. And there's a tube that goes all the way down to just above the bottom of the tank. So that way, if you want to charge your system with liquid refrigerant, you don't have to tip this whole tank upside down like you do a single use tank. So that's kind of nice. When I recover stuff, I always dump it into the vapor port, because that just dumps it into the top of the tank. If the tank is partially full of refrigerant and you're dumping vapor down the dip tube into the bottom of it, as it bubbles up, it can heat up the refrigerant and it gets real weird real fast. So when in doubt, vapor port for recovering and nothing bad happens. One final thing. You always want to make sure that you mark the recovery bottle with the type of refrigerant that's going to be in it. You don't want to mix refrigerants because the supply house will hate your guts for it. They will still take your money because they want your money, but secretly they hate your guts for it. So it's much better to label it so that way if you have a couple different tanks, you know exactly what's in it. So I have pressure in the system. That means the valve did pierce the side of the tube, so hooray for it. But I'm not registering any pressure on the recovery machine. So first what I want to do is open up this valve. And that connects the blue hose to the yellow hose.
Now if I come over here, you will see that it still registers zero. That's because the input valve is closed. Now this could be a liquid, it could be a vapor, it could be a combination of the two. When in doubt, if you don't want to slug the compressor in this thing, I go with liquid. And it's just easier on everything that way. Takes a little bit longer, but that's okay. This is a small system. That's the thing. I only work on the small type 1 systems, so what may take a while for a whole house air conditioning unit really doesn't matter here because the system's so small. So that's open. You can see that gauge picked up to about 70 something. This gauge picked up to about 70 something. Now I want to go ahead and open the output. So now we have pressure in this red hose. Okay, we have pressure up to this hose, but before I open the valve, I need to get the air that's in this whole system out because I've got a blue hose, a yellow hose, a recovery machine, all full of air. So I need to bleed this until I get refrigerant to this point. And the easiest way to do that is to just count 2 seconds for each hose. So in this case, I got 3 hoses, 2 seconds each. That's going to be 6 seconds. Sometimes you'll actually hear the thing change pitch and you know you've got refrigerant. So 6 seconds of purging or a pitch change, whichever comes first. So all I got to do is just loosen it up just a little bit. 1 Mississippi, 2 Mississippi, 3 Mississippi, 4 Mississippi, 5 Mississippi. There. Just takes a couple seconds to get the air out of the system. Now I can go ahead and open up this tank, and we should see the pressure on the gauges drop because this tank is in a vacuum right now. So it'll try and pull a lot of that refrigerant out all by itself. So, we watch the recovery machine. When I open the blue valve, we should see things start to drop. Now it's hard to tell on that gauge, but on the other gauge, I'm at negative 5 psi, and that's all I need to get to. 4 psi is what they say I need to get it down to. So I was able to recover everything that was in the system just using the vacuum in the bottle. I didn't even have to fire up the recovery machine. Makes me kind of sad because I was looking forward to using the recovery machine today, but you win some, you lose some. And if we have a look, we got 0.88 ounces of refrigerant out of this thing. There should be 15.5 if this thing was full. So, yeah, it was basically completely empty. There's a leak in it somewhere. We need to find the leak. I've swapped out the recovery machine with my trusty vacuum pump. Now what I want to do is continue to vacuum out the system down to as close to a perfect vacuum as possible. Then what I'm going to do is break the vacuum with nitrogen, which means I'm going to hook this up to the nitrogen bottle and let it backfill the system with nitrogen. The reason for that is I need to braze a service valve onto this thing, and I can't have nitrogen flowing through the system at the same time because I only have one opening in the system here. If I had 2 openings, I could take the core out of the service valve and flow nitrogen through it that way. In this case, what I need to do is get the rest of any contaminants that might be in there out, fill it with nitrogen, and then, because it's such a small system, it's not going to get oxygen in it fast enough to cause any kind of issue inside when I braze it. So, turn the vacuum pump on. Open up this and continue vacuuming it out. So I finished vacuuming it down, closed the knob, attached the nitrogen hose to it, and opened it back up. So now I've got it up to about 4 psi with the nitrogen. I'll take it up to 5 and call it good. Now I can go ahead and unclamp the piercing valve. There goes the nitrogen. But there should still be enough nitrogen in the system to not cause too much problems. And this is one of those things where you do the best you can to purge the inside, and you just have to hope for the best. There's not much you can do about it at this point. What I can do is get this wiring harness out of the way, because the last thing I want to do is burn through this with the torch. So they used copious amount of zip ties, so I will just cut the zip ties and then get this out of the way. I was able to get the entire control box pulled up and out of the way, so I have plenty of space here now to work on this thing. Now what I need to do is cut off the pinched section, and there's the little hole in the bottom from the piercing valve. So I'll just go back a little bit from there and use these tiny little tubing cutters. And they just barely spin around. And as you can see, there was the hole left by the piercing valve, so that's one less hole we have to braze up. Now we just need to attach the service valve to that little cutoff. So here we have the service valve, and it comes with a little copper tube stub already, a cap with a valve core removal tool built in, and then, of course, the valve core down in it. First thing we want to do is make sure we remove the valve core, because the heat of brazing it on there is going to melt the gasket in the valve core. So that needs to go be somewhere else, and we will reinstall it after. Now the next thing you want to do is make sure that after you install this thing, you can actually get the plastic case back on, because that would kind of wreck your day. So I'm going to have to trim this piece of copper off some in order to make it fit. Or the other thing I could do is simply bend the tube, and I think I'm just going to bend the tube. That might be the easiest thing. So I've got this little tubing bender, and all I have to do is find the correct spot right about there and then just bend it. There. And that should, yeah, that'll give me enough space. The only other thing I gotta do at this point, if you take a look, this is a 1/4 inch piece of copper tubing. This is a piece of 1/4 inch copper tubing. They just butt together. I need to make a flared connection so one of these can go over the other one. And I'm looking at the wall thickness. This one has a much thicker wall than this little stub. So I want to swedge
this one. And what a swedge does is it just expands the copper tubing so that way it'll fit over this one. So in order to swedge the thing, I'm going to use the swedge tool, which is just a whole bunch of steps, and I use a hammer with it.
There. So now we've got our swedged connection that this tube can fit right into. I'm ready to braze in the service valve, and you'll notice I attached it with a piece of copper wire just so that way if I accidentally bump it or something, it doesn't fall out before the braze solidifies. Speaking of the braze, I'm using the standard Silphos, silver phosphorus brazing rod. It's self-fluxing, so I don't have to use any flux on this, which is nice because that means there's no chance of anything getting into the system and contaminating it. For a torch, for you fellow torch enthusiasts out there, I am using a 1935 Victor J27 torch. It's a really nice little torch, and it's old. So, here we go. I want a slightly carburizing flame so that way I don't oxidize the tubing. And what I want to do is start on the service valve side because that goes into the other piece of tubing. And once I warm it up a little bit, I'll bring the flame back to the regular tubing. Now, it's probably going to melt some of the insulation on the actual piece of pipe, and you can see it just moved back on me just a little, so I will push it back in. We will try it again. Like I said, it'll probably burn some of the insulation on the other pipe. There's not much I can do about that. It'll get over it, hopefully. And as always, I don't want the flame to melt the brazing rod. I want the flame to heat up the copper pipe, and then the copper pipe melt the brazing rod. And I'll play the flame around it just a little bit to make sure it flows in there nicely. Then shut off the torch, and we can inspect the work.
And if we take a look, it's got a nice little fillet weld, didn't burn a hole in the tube, so I think that should be good. And of course we'll leak test that before we recharge the thing. Speaking of leak testing, now that we have the service valve on, we can hook this thing up to the nitrogen tank again and start looking for that pesky refrigerant leak. The first step of the leak test is to hook up the system to compressed nitrogen. You want to use nitrogen instead of compressed air, because some refrigerants, if exposed to air and pressure, could cause a fire. So you want to make sure you use nitrogen. Also, compressed air has moisture in it. Compressed nitrogen doesn't have much moisture in it at all. Ideally, it doesn't have any. However, it's not safe to simply hook up the hose directly to a nitrogen tank. You need a nitrogen regulator. And a regular air regulator for a compressor won't do it. It needs to be one specifically designed to handle high pressures. When this tank is full, it has right around 2,000 psi in it. That is way above the burst rating of the hose or the system in general. So again, you just want to be careful when dealing with things of super high pressure. Now I can go and use a bottle of soapy water to try and find the leak. When I had this thing all soaped up with soapy water, I heard this little bubbling sound, a very quiet bubbling sound when the dehumidifier in here shut off. I could hear, it's almost like a ticking sound. And I couldn't see any bubbles, but I could hear ticking coming from this coil.
So what I did is I used the highly scientific method of listening with a paper towel tube to try and pinpoint the noise as I went along. And right in here is the loudest point of the little bubbling sound. And the way I tested for it is I just sprayed some water in here, just plain old water, and then listened. And that was the loudest point of the little bubbling sound. Now, I can't see any bubbling when I put the soapy water on it. So it's a very small leak, or depending on what side of the pipe it's on, I'm just not going to see it. But I can hear it. So it's in here somewhere. So the next thing we got to do is start cutting all this fin out from around this tube. There's really no good way to go about cutting into one of these things. The best you can hope for is to just kind of go nuts at it, do as little damage to the surrounding fins as possible. The way to look at it is, yes, you're reducing the efficiency of it because more air is going to try and go through this opening than everywhere else, but in the whole scheme of things, that's a small percentage of this whole surface area. Also, this thing's going to be way more effective with this thing cut out but the leak fixed than if I left this thing alone and then it got thrown out because the thing leaks like a sieve. So what I like to do is cut away at it the best I can with a utility knife. The good thing is these aluminum fins are really, really soft. I got enough fins cut away that I was able to find a teeny tiny leak right there in a crease in the copper tubing. So I think it cracked when they bent this evaporator into a U-shape. I've still got nitrogen pressure in it, and I want to take the time now to clean this copper tubing with the emery cloth. And again, I want positive pressure in this thing so that way none of the grit goes down into the thing. Although, as small a leak as I found, I don't think grit could get down in here anyways. Okay, this is where things are going to get a little tricky. Because of the plastic fan housing right behind this coil, I can't point the torch this way because the flame is long enough that it's just going to melt the fan. So I'm actually going to have to use the torch in here with the flame popping out this side. That also means I got to light this thing with it sticking through the evaporator like this, because I can't light it above here, bring it down, because it's going to melt all these fins in its way. So again, this is just a little tricky. There. Again, carburizing flame. Want to keep it nice and low because this is very thin tubing. Again, it would be helpful if I could get to both sides of this tube, but I can't. So, gonna do what I can do. And that looks as good as it's gonna get. Shut off the torch.
And we'll see if that passes the leak test. Well, it appears to be passing the soapy water test. And I've got this thing cranked right up to just under 100 psi of compressed nitrogen because my regulator goes up to 100, so I didn't want to push it. Again, not the nicest looking braze in the world of brazing copper tubing, but it's not bubbling or making little ticking sounds anymore, so I'm going to call that a win. One thing I don't remember if I said before, I took the valve core out of the service valve when I did this, because you want to make sure that as the nitrogen that was left in the system expands from the heat, that it has a place to go. You don't want it to build up pressure right here, because if it builds up pressure, you're going to get a pinhole through the braze as it solidifies. That's also why it's really important to make sure you leak check it afterwards, just to make sure you didn't get a pinhole. Especially on something like this, where you're trying to cover a big area with braze, easy to get a pinhole. But doesn't look like we got a pinhole, so we can go ahead and refill this thing. I'm satisfied that the repair doesn't have a leak, so I've gone ahead and hooked up the gauges again to the system and the vacuum pump so we can start pulling a vacuum on this system to get ready to actually charge it with refrigerant. And you'll notice the gauges look slightly different than before, and that is because these have slightly bigger faces on the gauges, so I'm hoping it's a little easier for the camera to see what the heck they're up to. So here we go. Basically, just vacuum it out. I don't have a micron gauge. I wish I had a micron gauge, but I don't have one. So what I do is, a system this size, I let the vacuum pump sit on it for an hour. Is it the most accurate way to do it? No, but I've never had an issue doing it this way, so until I get around to purchasing a micron gauge, this is how I do it. An hour of vacuum, and it's good to go. So, first thing I want to do, make sure both knobs are closed. These are snug, and I'll turn on the vacuum. Okay, so we now have the vacuum pulled in the yellow line. We can go ahead and open up the blue line. We'll hear the vacuum pump change pitch just a little bit, and we'll be off and running. And there we go. So the gauge is holding steady right around just a little under negative 30 psi. So it sat like that for 15 minutes. It hasn't budged. So I think we're good to go in terms of not having any leaks in the system. So now I can go ahead and start recharging this. When we reclaimed what was left of the refrigerant in the system, we put it in this recovery cylinder. Now what I want to do is use as much of that as I can back in the system. Now this is pretty low because there wasn't a whole lot of refrigerant in there to begin with, and this was completely empty. So between almost no refrigerant in the system and absolutely nothing in the evacuated cylinder, it's not going to have a real high pressure. But that's okay, because there's a vacuum in the system right now that's going to help pull the refrigerant out of the recovery cylinder into the air conditioner. Plus, when I turn on the compressor, that's going to lower the pressure on the suction side even more to help pull the refrigerant out of the cylinder. So I'll pull out as much refrigerant as I can out of the cylinder. It's on the scale right now, so I'll be able to tell exactly how much came out, so that way I can go ahead and finish up with the single-use refrigerant cylinder that has new refrigerant in it. One thing I just want to point out about the new refrigerant cylinder over here, these are what refrigerant come in when it's brand new from the chemical company. These are one-time use cylinders. You can't use them as recovery cylinders. Once they're empty, you have to discard them. And you want to make sure that there's no refrigerant left in them. If you have to put in a recovery cylinder, put in a recovery cylinder, or just keep putting it in systems until eventually it's all gone. But once it's all gone, you want to take the valve off so that way there's no chance that somebody down the line could try and use this as a recovery cylinder, because they're just not beefy enough for that. This is a recovery cylinder. So what I'm going to do is hook up the yellow hose to the red line now. Now at the pressure that's in this cylinder, there shouldn't be any liquid refrigerant in there at all. It should all be as a vapor, but just to be on the safe side, stranger things have happened, I put it on the liquid side. Remember, there's a big dip tube that goes down to the bottom. So if there is liquid, that'll get pushed out first. With the one-time use cylinder, there is no dip tube. This one you have to flip upside down in order to get the liquid refrigerant out. And you want to take it out as a liquid, because as the vapor pushes down on it, you're going to get a lot more liquid into that system than you possibly could as a vapor. I've opened up the red valve on the recovery cylinder and I've zeroed out the scale so that way I can get an accurate measurement of how much refrigerant I can get out of that cylinder, because it is very, very critical to get the right amount of refrigerant in one of these systems. If you get too much refrigerant in it, it's going to get liquid refrigerant back through the suction line to the compressor, and you can do serious damage to the compressor. It's not made to try and compress a liquid, just vapor. So if you overcharge it, the compressor is not long for this world. If you undercharge it, the thing's just not going to perform the way you want. It might ice up, it'll have issues. So it's super critical you know exactly how much is going in this thing. That being said, I've opened up the red line. We have an issue. We have a vacuum in the blue hose, so there's nothing in there, just like the rest of the system. However, in the yellow hose, we have air right now between the refrigerant and here. So what I need to do is open this up so we can vent out the air. One piece of hose, so about 2 seconds. One Mississippi, two Mississippi. That's good enough for that. Now we can go ahead and start adding the refrigerant. So if I start opening the blue side, again, we're not doing anything with the red side. I'm just going to open it up and see where it goes from there. Okay, with the AC's compressor running, the suction line pressure is gradually going down, which is good, because as it gets closer and closer to zero, more and more refrigerant is getting pulled out of that recovery cylinder. So once it bottoms out at whatever PSI it decides to bottom out at, we'll know we have removed as much of that 0.88 ounces of refrigerant as we could have. I've got the brand new cylinder of refrigerant all set up on the scale and hooked up. Now I need to purge the yellow hose because I disconnected it from the recovery cylinder, so there's air in it once again. But before I turn the compressor back on and start filling it again, I figure there's one specific thing I need to point out before it starts making all kinds of noise. And that is,
It's going to be liquid refrigerant in the yellow hose. And so we need to have a phase change happen. It needs to go from a liquid to a gas before it gets to the suction side of the compressor, because if that liquid gets to the suction side of the compressor, bad things happen to the compressor and suddenly we have to replace the compressor. So what you're going to see is I will open this valve up in short bursts in order to use that as the restriction to cause the expansion, so that way by the time it gets down the hose it should be all in gas form. There are specific things you can get for this that go in line and will do the phase change automatically. They're about this long piece of brass and they're specifically designed for that. They speed it up a little bit because you don't have to be as picky in give it a short burst, let it settle, give it a short burst, let it settle. However, these things, and by these things I mean window air conditioners, or not window air conditioners, portable air conditioners, are strange.
I apologize for the shaky cam, but this is really the only way to get a good view of what's strange about portable air conditioners. And this is different than a window air conditioner, dehumidifier, refrigerator, anything like that. And that is, without the case on this thing, it will not pull air through the evaporator. This is where, this is the fan for cooling the room. It sucks air through the vents in the back of the plastic case, through the evaporator coil, up through all these spaces around the shroud. So it comes up and over, down in, and then gets blown out the front. The problem is I can't charge this thing with the plastic covers on because they cover everything up. So because of that, there's no airflow across this evaporator, which means I have to add a little bit of refrigerant and give it a good long time to make sure I don't suck liquid all the way through this thing, because you're going to see this thing will start frosting up pretty good here in a minute, and you'll see the frost grow until eventually it's filled and the coil just isn't below freezing anymore. But until, while it's undercharged, it's going to be below freezing in here and you'll see ice build up on this thing. You just want to be careful of that. You also know I still have the two evaporator coils separated because I still want to just check this one more time before I button everything up with the full refrigerant load in it, because that's a higher pressure than I can go with the nitrogen. Just as one final sanity check on the thing. Okay, so here we go. We can see here, if we look at the scale, the needle is pointing to about 68 degrees. So this the big blue bar is 410A refrigerant, which is what this is. And so the needle shows the pressure, the blue scale shows the boiling point for that pressure. And here the boiling point is 68 degrees. Well, the shop temperature right now is 72 degrees. So therefore it is undercharged because it should be pointing right at the 72 right now when everything's at steady state. Of course the red says zero because the red hose isn't connected to anything. Okay, let's start up the compressor and we will start charging. You can see as soon as I turn on the compressor, suction line pressure drops. If we had the red line hooked up to the high side, you'd see that start to pick up. First thing I need to do is purge the yellow hose. I just purged the yellow hose, so I know I've got liquid refrigerant up to this point. We should be able to see some of the liquid refrigerant in this little glass window in a second. Now what I gotta do is just give it a short burst, about 2 seconds, stop. There, even less.
Again, you want to take your time. There's no crime in going too slow at this stage, because after all your hard work, you don't want to blow up the compressor. Also, if at any time the compressor starts sounding weird, stop adding refrigerant. I'm at the final step of filling up this air conditioner. I've tipped the tank back over and I've turned off the valve because I'm all done, but there's an issue. This yellow hose has liquid refrigerant in it, so it's got quite a bit of refrigerant in it, and the way it was hanging off the table, the scale was measuring that as some of the refrigerant that was taken out of this cylinder. So I need to get that refrigerant, or as much of it as I can, into the system. The way I can do that is by letting it in a little bit at a time on the low side, just like before, until it's all in the system.
And one more sanity check, just to make sure, for my own curiosity. Yeah. No more bubbles. There we go. It's an air conditioner. So that's all there is to refilling an air conditioner. Simple, huh?